The difference between Bitcoin and cash is that cash is fungible, at least if it's a coin. If it's a gold coin, it's really no different from any other gold coin. And so one is as good as another. That's not quite true with notes, because notes are serial numbers, but let's ignore that for the time being. Now, those other things are fungible, like ears of corn, or in the old days, sheep. In Roman times, if 20 sheep wandered from Marcus's farm into Crassus's farm, then the court could simply tell Crassus to give Marcus 20 sheep back, and any 20 sheep, it didn't matter. But nowadays, of course, sheep have got little electronic passports clipped into their ears. So if that were to happen between two Italian farms nowadays, then Marcus could go and get exactly the right 20 sheep back from Crassus. So here's an example of how technology has made sheep from a fungible asset into a trackable asset. Now, Bitcoin's the same, because every Bitcoin carries with it pointers to its entire history. So you can see everybody who's owned that Bitcoin or parts of it ever since these parts were originally mined. And so you can see whether parts of that Bitcoin were stolen at some time or another, or whether they went through money laundering schemes, or whether they were used in the drugs trade, or have got various other objectionable qualities that might cause the authorities to want to call them in and have a close look at them.
What about the money laundering thing then? How does that work?
At present, in England, you can't get good title to stolen goods. But until 1995, you could, because there was a law called the law of market overt. So if I stole your horse and I went and sold it in Cambridge Market between dawn and dusk, then somebody who bought it from me in good faith would end up owning the horse. And all you could then do was to sue me or get me hanged or sent to Virginia. Now, this was abolished in 1995 because it was being abused. But the rule survives in the law of money and banking. Now, if you go to a Barclays Bank ATM, for example, and you get out a £20 note, then even if that £20 note was stolen last year in a bank robbery, that's not your problem. That's Barclays Bank's problem, because you got it from a regulated financial institution, and so your title to it is certain. Similarly, if you go to John Lewis's and you buy a toaster for 30 quid and you pay them with a 50 and you've got a £20 note in your change, then you own that £20 note, because there's another rule which says that if you get something for value in good faith, right, then if so long as that something is money, you get good title to it. So the Bitcoin people have been lobbying for at least 5 years to have Bitcoin to be declared money. Because if Bitcoin becomes money, then they think that many of the problems around stolen Bitcoins and Bitcoins that were used in the drugs trade and so on would go away. So we've been looking into this, and it turns out that it isn't quite true. Now, no government has yet admitted that Bitcoin is money, but even if a court were to find that Bitcoin is money, as courts, for example, found that carbon credits can be treated as money for some purposes, then it doesn't get the Bitcoin criminals off the hook. And the reason for this is that to get good title to something that was once stolen, you have to do it in good faith. Now, what's the meaning of in good faith? Somebody might argue that you can't get a Bitcoin in good faith because everybody knows there's so much bad stuff goes on in Bitcoin. But even if you don't buy that argument, there's another problem, which is that many people in the Bitcoin world have set up what they call Bitcoin mixes or even Bitcoin laundries, where the idea is that you take along your stolen Bitcoin or the Bitcoin that you got from selling hashish from sheep market or whatever. You put this black Bitcoin into a pot and 9 other people come along and put in their white Bitcoins into the pot, and you shake the pot very, very hard and you kind of hope that you get 10 white Bitcoins out. Now, the law is quite clear on this, that if there's money laundering, then you can't have good faith. And so if you put one black Bitcoin and 9 white Bitcoins into a pot and you shake it, then if Bitcoins are held to be money, what you get out is 10 black Bitcoins. Sorry, guys. Asking for Bitcoin to be money was the wrong thing to ask for. Because if Bitcoin had simply remained a commodity, pig iron bars or whatever, then this magic wouldn't happen. The stolen pig iron bar would still be a stolen pig iron bar. You would put the one black Bitcoin and the 9 white Bitcoins into a pot and you'd shake them, and then some unlucky sod would get the black one out. And in that case, of course, economics kicks in, because then nobody's got an incentive to take part in a money laundering scheme. Now, the interesting thing about this is that if Bitcoin become money or are treated as money for some purposes, then this is a really mortal threat to those cryptocurrencies which provide built-in laundries, such as Monero and Zcash. Now, in Zcash, for example, most of the time it works just like Bitcoin, and there's a fully traceable blockchain of who passed on a coin to whom. But you can, if you want, take your zero coin and you can put it back in the mine and have it remined and get out one that's nice and shiny and new, in the sense that it's indistinguishable from all the other coins mined in that round. Just the same as if you've been recasting a gold bar, or you've taken a gold bar to a crooked foundry or a bent goldsmith and got it turned into something that was untraceable. But the effect of this, according to the law of money and banking, is actually to poison every single coin that comes out of that mine. And this would lead regulators to ask themselves whether or not they should simply instruct regulated Bitcoin exchanges not under any circumstances to change cash or other cryptocurrencies into currencies such as Zcash or Monero, on the grounds that these were designed for the purpose of money laundering, and therefore there was an issue of obstruction of justice. First out, or FIFO, is something that programmers and communications engineers understand very, very well. So we went and wrote some software which does a FIFO taint of the blockchain. And so whenever coins are stolen and put in a transaction, perhaps joined with other coins, the coins that went in first